the five yadnas.
Well, what are those five yadnas?
I'll tell you. Okay, those five yadnas are Deva yadna, Pitra yadna, Rishi yadna, Manushi yadna, Bhuta yadna.
Okay.
We are, for our survival, depend on these five aspects of creation.
Okay.
Just like just like for your survival, you depend on the corporate.
Mm-hmm.
And you give back to something to the corporate.
Mm.
Right? For our life, we depend on five aspects of creation.
Okay.
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 The first aspect of creation is called Deva Yadna, Devata.
Okay. That is?
Devatas are forces of nature. Yeah, the forces of nature which are responsible for sustaining the balance and life form in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's rain or sunshine or all these natural elements which are conscious in nature.
Okay.
It's called Deva Yadna. Okay. So now how we can pay them back?
Homas, pujas.
Homas and pujas is one way. By participating in actions which lead to more and more balance in the nature is called Deva Yadna.
Okay.
Whatever you do, contribution to environmental ecosystem is a part of Deva Yadna.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Homa and rituals is one way of puja, worship.
Okay.
Okay. Worship to God.
They are so, part of, for example, while having a bath, I don't waste water. I mean, what
everything,
I do to my
everything which you come back and contribute to society in terms of environmental balance,
okay,
ecosystem is called Deva Yadna.
Okay.
Okay, so that also probably including the bringing the awareness in people about that, contributing to environmental balance.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Then that includes also puja. So you give formal thanks to all the divine forces.
Mm-hmm.
That's Deva Yadna. Then second thing is called Pitra Yadna.
Okay.
So Pitra Yadna means your life is a continuous process.
Mm-hmm.
Several generations of your ancestors have worked for your life form.
Mm-hmm.
Even your parents have worked.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's not easy life to take give a birth to a child and take it, bring him up. It's not easy life.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. So, contribution to, or rather giving respect to them, and contribution to the elderly care is what is called Pitra Yadna.
Okay.
Right?
Okay, yeah.
Okay, it's not the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
So, what happened was, there was a system where the grandparents had some wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
Then the grandchildren used to played with the grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
The wisdom used to get transferred from the grandparent to the child,
mm-hmm,
in terms of stories and whatever, mm-hmm, is that. Now that has collapsed.
Mm-hmm.
Because grandparents live somewhere, the child lives somewhere.
Yeah.
Okay. So now any act which you do,
mm-hmm,
to bring the wisdom to the children in terms of spiritual education is a part, mm-hmm, of the Pitra Yadna.
Okay.
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 So that is for your child, your family, or society at a large.
Mm-hmm.
Because your family is for your survival, society at a large is your contribution back to the society.
Okay. Okay.
Right? That's called Pitra Yadna. So taking care of the senior citizens,
mm-hmm,
of your family,
mm-hmm,
and senior citizens as a larger community,
mm-hmm,
taking care of spiritual education for your children,
mm-hmm,
or taking care of the spiritual education in general as a community,
mm-hmm,
is a part of Pitra Yadna.
Okay.
Okay. Then comes the Manushya Yadna. Manushya Yadna is, our life is depend on all these factors, Pitras, Devatas, and human beings.
Mm-hmm.
One person or other person contributes to our life.
Mm-hmm.
And contributing back what we have to those who don't have in some way, a service to humanity in whatever form is called Manushya Yadna.
Okay.
Then comes Bhuta Yadna.
Bhuta
means Bhuta. Bhuta means living beings.
Okay.
So our life is dependent on various life forms.
Mm-hmm.
Right? All life forms are connected.
Correct.
Okay. If some life form dies somewhere, a part of us also dies. If frogs die in Africa, the disease will strike in some other country. Because the frogs will eat mosquitoes, when the frogs are not there, the mosquitoes will travel somewhere. They infect human beings.
Correct.
Like that, you can see that Ebola or any virus spreading globally. So what happens is that the life form, our life is dependent on so many life forms. So any act of compassion to living beings is called Bhuta Yadna.
Okay.
Then finally,
Rishi Yadna.
Okay. So Rishis are the people who have passed on the enlightened wisdom, the spiritual wisdom, in the form of Bhagavad Gita, Upanishads, and various teachings.
Okay.
So first is a study of that for our own life. Second thing is teaching of that to other people who need it to pass on the message is called Rishi Yadna. So these are the five yadnas.
Okay.
So when you bring that five yadnas in your life, you have brought dharma into your life.
Okay.
Because adharma is not giving back what you got. Right?
Yeah.
So when husband and wife are committed to these five yadnas, then the house becomes a dharmic family.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And why you have to commit for dharma? Is because by committing to dharma, the mind will become purified and you will evolve for mukti, liberation. So if the focus of the grihastha life is liberation, dharma is the means, then that is a grihastha ashrama. Okay? Any questions?
Now you imagine Vanaprastha. At that time Vanaprastha, that time the whole of the country was full of forests. And village was only small, this small. Right?
Yeah.
Isn't it? Village was
pretty small.
Yeah. And the whole country was poor. Now this guy, even from that small village he goes out. Which is funny. Right? Here, even if you go a little bit outside, you'll get a forest there. But now there's no forest. So why he was doing that, means he was reducing the connect with the society, because the moment you are in the society, your interaction will increase. So he's trying to reduce the interactions. Okay? So more peace. He used to teach to other people. Okay, other people that this is what dharma is, this is what I learned in life. He used to teach. Some amount of time he spends in teaching, some amount of time he spends in his own. Then beyond the stage, he may take to sannyasa. If vasanas drop out, it happens a natural process. Okay, then you take sannyasa. The sannyasa is a process by which vasanas get dropped out gradually. Okay, that is the sannyasa.
Okay.
Sannyasa means samyagnyasa. When your mind gets focused on higher, the lower will fall. That's called sannyasa. Now these are the four stages, which is natural evolution process of human being. Even if you take sannyasa, there's no guarantee that you get liberation. Enlightenment. Okay? Enlightenment is wisdom which has to come. Okay? Sannyasa is a negative process.
Okay.
He has...
Oh, so just because you're doing sannyasa doesn't mean wisdom will come.
That's because... I'll tell you like the other way. Like, they're a scientist. Okay? A Nobel laureate. Works 7 days a week in the lab.
Okay.
He doesn't take food and all. He's researching for some molecule. Okay? Then, because of his intense effort, he gets the molecule and he gets a Nobel Prize. Now, I'll say, you do 7 days of fasting, then you'll get Nobel Prize. It is not wise, also true.
in the process of discovering molecule, you did 7 days fasting.
Mm.
But if you do 7 days fasting, you will not get a molecule.
Mm.
That is the...
Mm.
So whatever sannyasa is a process by which you drop. That doesn't really mean that you will get something.
Okay, okay.
Okay. That's what happens to many people. So now, this was the earlier stage of ashrams in the earlier days.
Mm-hmm.
And each ashram had a dharma to follow.
Mm-hmm.
A way of living.
Mm-hmm.
That's called dharma. Now today, you take at the today's situation where things have changed.
Mm-hmm.
Things have drastically changed. What has happened is, there is no system of spiritual education. Okay? Anywhere in the schools.
Mm-hmm.
There's scientific education.
Mm-hmm.
There's a value education.
Mm-hmm.
Value education is different from spiritual education.
Mm-hmm.
Value education is, tells you to do this or not to do this. To follow the rules, not to follow this thing. Do something.
Mm-hmm.
To keep the clean. It gives some amount of discipline.
Mm-hmm.
But spiritual education is not about what to do. Spiritual education is about why to do.
Mm.
Okay.
Correct. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Why to do. So that is missing. Now let us say a boy is there. Because of the today's internet and TV and all. In the age of 8 itself, he is completely, he is exposed to so much of sex and violence.
Mm-hmm.
In the school when he sits, the thoughts of sex and violence come to his mind.
Yeah,
now, by obviously. Definition, by your definition, he is a brahmacharya because he is not married.
Okay.
If you
okay.
wrongly apply the word brahmacharya,
yeah,
he is not married.
He is not married, yeah.
Okay. Now, if he is not married, he is not brahmachari. Because
okay.
marriage is not about physical, marriage is about psychological.
Psychological, right.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So, because of so much of information exposure,
mm-hmm.
his already mind is already corrupted.
Correct.
Now, should you call him as brahmachari by your definition of celibacy?
Or
you should be calling him a married person?
Yeah, I see your point, yeah.
Okay.
Correct, correct, correct.
Understood.
Yeah.
So, now,
Ampere.
What happened was, actually, one of my friends, his wife was pregnant actually.
Okay.
And he used to go to office, and when this lady was in prison, she was alone at home, she used to get some very, very vulgar letters, which are pushed to the door.
Oh.
Okay. So now, she didn't know what was happening.
And who was putting it?
Was putting it. Then one day, this man, pretended he is going to office, but he hid in the house. Okay, then what happened was, he saw one kid coming and disappearing there, playing. So then, he ran out. There was a letter there, opened the door, and only person who was going out was the kid. He asked the kid, who is that? So he said, one big dadi wala has came and ran away. This guy is watching. Okay, that guy is 8-year-old kid. That guy was writing letter.
Okay.
Okay. Now, you should call, I'm saying, the system has changed.
Yeah. Yeah,
there's
yeah.
so much of information exposure. This guy,
yeah.
this kid is corrupted.
Mm-hmm.
Now, should he call him as brahmachari or grahastha at that level? If your definition is marriage is about marriage is about
being celibate. Or
celibate.
Not, yeah, I see your point. Yeah.
Okay. So, this guy is a different state.
So, then if you look at it that way, but then what about the psych? Okay. So, this is the psychology
so
aspect.
So, please understand,
about.
Anything in Indian scripture
yeah,
is
yeah.
not physical, it's psychological.
Yeah.
Mm. Okay. That we are applying is physical.
Oh, that is why Amma says Krishna is Nitya Brahmachari. She says all that.
Krishna Nitya Brahmachari, I'll tell you. What is that?
Confused about that.
So, it is a psychological evolution, not a physical thing.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. So now, from Brahmachari, this guy, there is now this somebody is married.
Hmm.
Okay. So the married person, he is supposed to follow dharma.
Okay.
There is some dharma for a married person.
Okay. Yeah.
So a married person has to follow panchayadna. That is the prescription of your days.
What is that?
I'll tell you. At the time of marriage.
A divan of taka.
I'm telling you what is the Vedic principle and what has happened today, I'll tell you.
That's
okay. So, at the time of marriage, husband and wife used to take a oath.
Okay.
That's called Saptapadi. Now, do you know what oath you take? And
no.
Nobody knows actually.
Nobody, I don't know.
No, nobody knows. Even the Purohit doesn't know.
Okay.
So, okay, both will go around saying something.
Okay.
And in the front of Agni as a god.
Okay.
And sign of a contract. It is similar to your the account, this thing you sign in a bank loan. So you have to say a 25-page document. So many things you sign off without knowing what, because you don't have patience to read.
Correct.
Sign off.
No, they should teach this to people because people just do it without.
There is no they. There is you.
No, but I'm saying the pundits and all should teach the people what.
Boss, there is no they. You are responsible. I am responsible. That's all. Don't worry. Don't put shift responsibility somebody else.
Okay.
There's nobody.
I am responsible.
Okay. Even if I drop shift responsibility somebody else.
Okay.
There's nobody.
Okay.
If there's a problem you see, I am responsible. You are responsible. If there's a problem which you see, I am responsible. They don't put the blame on somebody. They are responsible. That's not possible.
Yeah.
So now what you say, what these people say is, we together, we will perform dharma, artha, kama, moksha. Four of this we get married.
Okay.
Okay. That is the contract they are signing.
Okay.
Now, why we are doing it is to get moksha, liberation, in this lifetime.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Correct. Yeah.
If you don't get it, we will commit for 7 lifetimes together.
Okay. Okay.
7 lifetimes is a failure condition.
Okay. I see.
Okay. So now, what happens is the marriage, people forget dharma. It becomes artha and kama. Okay, money and desire.
No, but if you see, most married people follow dharma, right? They follow the dharma.
Provided you know what is dharma.
Yeah, okay, agreed.
Okay.
I mean, you don't do anything wrong, you follow the...
Provided you know what is dharma. The definition of dharma itself, Dharmaraya himself was struggling with the definition of dharma. Dharmaraya Pandavas, who is supposed to be, name is Dharmaraya. Dharma is very, very subtle. Okay. It is it's like a gross to subtle, it will go evolve. It is very subtle. Dharma, as you evolve, the understanding of dharma becomes more and more sharper and clearer. It's very gross at certain level.
That's your point, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then what happens if you live your life properly, okay, the dharma itself will take you to a higher level of evolution.
Agreed. Okay.
Now the problem is, what is proper living? That information is not there. That education is not there. Then people tend to live a legal, a right way of living.
Okay.
Legal right way of living is not, is a prerequisite, not dharma alone.
Correct. Okay.
Understand?
I see.
So you go on the left side or right side of the road. If you go on the left side of the road, you'll be by a police. Many people will follow. Because it's a legal system. Like that, dharma people follow. But what is subtle nature of dharma? Dharayati dharma. Dharma is the one which protects you, uplifts you. That will be missing in their life.
Oh, okay. So how? What is the distinction between these two now? So, okay. So the person is driving on the right side of the road because he's afraid of police catching him. Versus a person who follows it just for the sake of doing it. I mean, the dharma from the higher sense of the word, what you're talking about. How do you define that?
I will take dharma itself as a separate discussion.
Okay.
Because this will get into, it is ashrama you are discussing.
Okay. And okay, we'll keep that aside and talk about that.
Because dharma itself is very subtle and gentle.
Huh.
So now people don't have adequate exposure. So they live life as per what they want.
Okay.
That's what happens. So then what will happen is that the vasanas, the grahastha ashrama is supposed to be reducing your vasanas and making it free of vasanas. Instead, that becomes the accumulation of vasanas. It's the other counter process.
So how do you make married life reduction of vasanas?
That I'll say, what is dharma?
Okay.
That dharma is the process. It's a prescription for that.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
So that doesn't happen. Because it doesn't happen, it becomes an accumulation of vasanas rather than
agreed, yeah.
Okay. The medicine is not there.
Right.
So then what happens? Grahastha ashrama becomes stressful. And there's no ashrama there. There's only shrama. Okay. As vasanas get accumulated, it becomes a shrama. Okay. So now this is where people are. Now let us say somebody is married, but he is constantly thinking of God or dedicating his life to spiritual. In spite of doing his work in office or home, then by your definition, is he a grahastha ashrami or sannyasi?
I mean, by the physical definition, he's a is man.
Physical definition is irrelevant,
yeah.
Actually.
But psychologically, yeah, he's a sannyasi.
In the spiritual parlance, the physical has no meaning at all.
I see your point. Yeah, yeah.
And for the common people, only physical has the meaning.
Right. Correct. I see your point.
Okay.
Yeah.
So now, this person lives in the life, but all actions is dedication to God, and he lives his life for spiritual evolution.
Okay.
Then by definition of scriptures, he is actually sannyasa.
Right.
Why? Sannyasa is samyak nyasa. One whose mind is focused on liberation, God, is called sannyasi.
Right.
It has a mental definition, it's no physical definition.
Agreed. Yeah.
Okay. Physical definition of I leave my ashram, I wear a saffron dress, that is actually is a way of living, not a state of the mind.
Agreed.
Sannyasa is a state of the mind.
Right.
Okay.
It is not, yeah, totally agree. Yeah.
Okay. Now, actually, we should not mix up two things. A state of mind and way of living. There are two different things. Okay. So, now, he lives like that. Then, somebody goes to Vanaprastha. In Vanaprastha, there is no equivalent word in English today. I'll say retired life.
Okay.
Okay. Now, retired life is supposed to be spent on contemplation of spiritual practices. It's called contemplation. In Grahastha Ashrama, it involves more of a karma. Karma means not physical karma, the prescribed rituals. Okay, for example, you do some puja, all those things. In Vanaprastha, two things are prescribed. One is called upasana, okay? Another is contemplation. Contemplation, a word I don't know in upasana, Sanskrit, but it's upasana. Upasana is different from the rituals which you follow. Okay, it is a deeper inner meaning of the upasana. So when somebody is in Grahastha Ashram, he can perform a yadna, which involves inviting people. Like today, somebody she attended yadna. Mm-hmm. So many people come, and there is money involved, and you direct connection. So now in Vanaprastha, you are retired. There is no money. Instead of doing physically, you try to understand deeper, go deeper into the psychological essence of that, and then it becomes called upasana.
Okay.
So yadna, you understand, is not just fire. Yadna means actually the fire of wisdom. In what you offer in yadna is not ghee or rice or clothes. You are offering your impressions, vasanas. So these are all psychological inner meaning of the yadna. So that contemplation happens in Vanaprastha Ashram.
Okay.
Now you tell me how people spend in Vanaprastha Ashram today, retired life here today.
Go play cards or golf, I don't know what people do.
50 to 60% of time it goes in cricket. Oh,
okay, cricket and...
Okay, India. Another 60% time goes in politics. Okay. Right?
And being worried about the children.
It's 24 hours, okay? The sleep is gone in worrying about the children and their grandchildren. Okay, rest of the time is worried about the money. Okay. So now, instead of vasana dropping, it becomes accumulation. That's not Vanaprastha Ashram. So Vanaprastha Ashram may say, well, fine, this is all over, what I have done is done. Now let me not worry about this thing. Let me cut off my... Why Vanaprastha then? Why go to forest? Okay. Now imagine a city of earlier days, maybe about 500 families. Okay. A 500 family system also generates a lot of social interaction. Any social interaction generates noise. Now imagine a city of 2 billion, 20 million people, 25 million people.
Right.
So much of social interaction will be there.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So reduce that social interaction and spend time on contemplation. That's the Vanaprastha.
Right.
So now if a person doesn't do that, then he is not in Vanaprastha Ashram. The definition of ashrama is where mind becomes deeply silent. Now the question is, has that become silent? In Grahastha Ashrama, the mind has to become silent. Has it become silent? In Brahmacharya, mind has to become silent. Has it become silent?
In none of them, currently, the mind is silent.
Not silent because that ashrama dharma is not followed.
Right.
Okay. Each ashrama is a dharma.
Right.
So now he goes to Vanaprastha. Then his mind has become totally silent. He has become free from vasanas. Then it is a stage called sannyasa. It's a psychological evolution. Now let us take the other case. There are many people who have taken sannyasa immaturely.
Correct.
Okay. So the mind is always constantly hankering after what you left. Okay. if there's imagery. Okay?
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
The Grahastashrama and Sannyasashrama are related to psychological conditioning.
Right.
If Sannyasi is spending his lifetime thinking of things what he has left, then what, which ashrama is in?
It's back to Grahastashrama. I mean, the
psychological
state. Yeah.
Okay. Psychological state. So now he is in the Grahastashrama. So now this is the what ashrama system was earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The ashrama system is, please understand, every word is ashrama. Now our concept of ashrama is somewhere place.
I totally understand now. Yeah.
Okay. Where the mind becomes peaceful, mind becomes silent, the vasanas drop is called ashrama.
Mm-hmm.
Now the moment ashrama comes, thought comes, oh, it's some place.
Some other place.
It is
It's not.
Where you are, you have to convert into ashrama.
Right.
That is
or otherwise, you might go to a physical ashrama and convert it into the world out.
Now what happens is that, okay, so this life you are not living in a dharmic way because you don't know what is dharma.
Right.
Okay, you don't have exposure.
Okay.
Okay, then what happens? The life, mind becomes more and more disturbed. Okay. And vasanas will accumulate. Then they seek something where they can drop their vasanas or reduce the stress because they don't know what is going on.
Right.
So now they seek a spiritual center where they want to go and settle. I mean, to tell you very, very clearly, spiritual center is a ICU, intensive care unit.
Okay. Oh, then that makes total sense. Seeing I have seen 2-3 ashramas till now, I was wondering what the hell is happening.
It is a ICU.
Okay.
Okay. When somebody, you have said this is fever or something, you take medicine locally. When you become intensely diseased.
But I am not agreeing.
No, I'm telling you what is the situation.
Not for all of them are in ICU.
He's talking about the concept of...
I'm saying what is happening today, I'm telling you. Mm-hmm. Okay? Right? So what is the concept and what is reality, I'm telling you. Don't mix up, I'm telling something against dharma. I'm telling you what is happening. Okay. So now what happens is, becomes ICU is nothing wrong actually. You need some treatment.
Okay.
You go there. So this becomes a large class of people.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then there are people, okay, there are who are dedicated. There are doctors, nurses, there are so many people. So they help you, try to do help. And in equivalent of that is some monks, somebody, Brahmacharya. They try to help you. But the load is, today's world is so much, it's overflowing in this situation.
Yeah.
Because the problem is somewhere.
Yeah.
Okay. See, let us say there's a disease somewhere. Now, hospital get bombarded with somehow, thousands of people.
Yeah.
Huh? Why? The hospital only, very people who need a lot of attention should come. But now, there's a sort of, flow of people. Because there is somewhere something is missing. The problem has to be addressed at source, not at the destination. Okay?
Yeah.
So that's where some spiritual practices, some satsangs, all those things will happen at home.
Okay.
Just to reduce the intensity.
Correct. Yeah.
That's what Amma does in terms of all those.
Uh-huh.
Right? Satsangs and all. So you give some facility nearby. Okay? So the body of an enlightened being is the satsang. The body of enlightened being is the teaching. They are not physical body.
Not physical body, right.
Okay. That's what happened. The physical body gets extended to all over the world.
Correct. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. But what happens is that still a spiritual evolution requires a individual attention. Okay. Understand? It is not because our mind is so plays a game. We start twisting the spiritual truths to our own convenience, our own vasanas. A realized master will be able to see that and reflect back. That facility which is there in the presence of a realized master. Okay. Ashram provides an initial level of support. But then finally it requires some amount of this equivalent of, I am telling you, PhD, doctorate program. So in the primary school there are some 1 million students study up to SLC. Some 4 lakh people go to POC. Engineering people complete, some 10,000 people complete engineering. Then out of that, master's program on 5,000 people will do. The doctorate program, some 100 people will do. At the time of doing doctorate program, 100 people, they need the attention of a guide. Each person requires one interaction.
Correct.
Right? So similarly, same thing happens in spirituality also. Mm-hmm. At first level, there is ashram, there is scriptures. The second level, there is service. So you start evolving. Mm-hmm. And finally, it requires a personal guidance and attention from the master.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, what happens? We start taking whatever we have listened, we twist that according to our vasanas.
Correct.
Okay?
Agreed, yeah.
Understand. You wrap it up.
That makes sense, yeah. Understand.
There's nobody to tell you, reflect back to you.
Yeah.
This is the reality.
Yeah.
Alright? So what do you see in the house? You see your wife, your husband.
But then if the Mahatma is truly a Mahatma, but then how will they be able to go to the individual level when there are tons of people or so many people?
It's very difficult. The issue here is, the Mahatmas are rare.
Mm-hmm.
Why they are rare?
I don't know why they are
in India has a beautiful system which produces realized beings in larger volume.
Mm-hmm.
A good education, spiritual education, makes the possibility of producing more realized beings at a required for society.
Yeah.
So okay. There was a realized Brahmana, realized Kshatriya, realized Vaishya, realized Shudra. Okay,
uh-huh.
That was the society which produced it in larger volume.
Uh-huh.
When you are not able to produce in larger volume, it becomes exceptional.
Uh-huh.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
A realized being can run a country.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Now Modi is a yogi.
Yeah.
He can run a country.
Yeah.
Okay. Now if he wears a saffron dress, you call him as monk.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay. But uh-huh. That was the society which produced it in larger volume.
Uh-huh.
When you are not able to produce in larger volume, it becomes exceptional. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
A realized being can run a country.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Now Modi is a yogi.
Yeah.
He can run a country.
Yeah.
Okay. Now if he wears a saffron dress, you call him as monk.
Yeah.
But he doesn't wear a saffron dress, but same job he does sitting as a prime minister.
Yeah, yeah.
Understand?
Yeah.
We need people, realized people at various stages of life.
Okay.
That's what our earlier system produced.
Right.
A system which produced such beings.
Okay, okay.
Okay. Uh-huh. Now the collapse of the system is leading to such a, what I'm saying is,
lack of mahatmas.
Gifted. Okay. Now for example, there's a musical talent is there, right? Let's say some genius. Oh, one genius, fine. But can you produce some thousands of people who are not that level, but good enough?
Mm.
That was missing.
Mm.
That's what happened to India.
Mm.
India was subjected to attacks for almost 1,000 years.
Mm.
In that attack, systematically the education, spiritual system was destroyed.
Mm.
So which led to lack of people of caliber at various stages.
Yeah, yeah.
So now, what is required is, at a ground level, you have to build up the system.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Slow process, but it has to happen.
It has.
Okay. Then there are the exceptional people like Amma or maybe Modi. Okay. Those who come and try to set it at a very larger level.
Mm.
But the work has to also happen at a very micro level, grassroots level.
Mm. Yeah, that's your point.
Okay.
So then, back to that earlier, this of the definition of dharma and all, right? So it is not just what is right and what is wrong, right?
What is right and what is wrong is very, very difficult to judge.
Okay.
Okay. In a sense, it's what's right and what is wrong. Okay.
Yeah.
But dharma is very simple definition of dharma. Is what you should do, what, let us say, you expect me not to do something to you.
Okay.
I should not do to you.
Correct.
Okay. Okay. If you feel that you should not be killed, right? Nobody should hurt me. Then you should not hurt anybody. It's a.
But then by that definition, let's say I do something which doesn't cause harm. Let's say.
No,
I'm
saying
and smoking.
I'm saying. It starts at a very, very gross level. It goes into very more subtle level.
Oh, I see.
Okay, it is first definition is that.
That, okay.
Okay. Now, then it starts evolving.
Mm.
As you mature, it starts evolving. Okay. Now you come to your smoking.
I'm just giving an example. If I do something, let's say I take drugs.
Mm.
Okay. It doesn't hurt anybody else.
No. Then it comes to the definition of dharma. Dharayati iti dharma. Dharma is something which protects you, upholds you.
Okay.
If you take
upholds you, in what sense? Physical, mental, spiritual, like that.
All the levels.
Okay.
Okay. Which really causes your upliftment.
So, drugs might give me. Okay, I see your point.
Okay. So that's next level of definition. If it's dharma has some interaction level, I should not do something which I don't want you to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's one level, interaction level. At individual level, something which upholds me is dharma.
Okay, I see your point.
Right? So now,
okay,
the dharma itself can be applied very wrongly.
Okay.
Ahimsa paramo dharma. Non-violence is supreme principle.
Okay.
Is it true? Okay. Is it true all the time?
No, by that definition, then so many Mahatmas eat non-vegetarian food. I mean, Ramakrishna Paramahansa used to eat fish.
No, no. Let's take vegetarian. Non-violence is paramadharma.
Mm.
Okay. Now, what happened was, we fell into the trap. India fell into the trap. When the foreign invaders attacked, we became complacent.
Okay.
Because kshatriyas, the violence... there is a violence against you. Now, you have to protect yourself.
Yeah.
Then it's not violence.
Yeah.
Okay. So many times what happened is these people attack and we forgave them and sent it back. And they recuperated and became strong and attacked back again.
Uh-huh.
So that's not dharma.
Yeah.
So dharma definition itself, you take something grossly, then you'll in trouble.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. So now what happens, the whole series of India last about 1,000 years, the kshatriyas fell like pins. First, they became selfish, they forgot their dharma.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing is the wrong concept of non-violence got into their head.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So, dharma is something which uplifts you constantly. Mm-hmm. This is dharma. So, what uplifts you constantly? Your actions.
Okay.
Your thoughts.
Uh-huh.
Right? Your actions, your thoughts, and your lifestyle.
Okay.
Right? So, bringing that into your life,
mm-hmm.
in your thoughts, actions, and in your lifestyle is mm-hmm. called dharma.
No, bringing what into your actions, thoughts, and lifestyle? The
actions which uplift you.
Okay.
Thoughts which uplift you. Lifestyle which uplifts you is dharma.
Okay.
Okay.
I see. Then that would be the right definition. Exactly.
Now, the problem is, what uplifts you, nobody knows. Okay. Today people eat proper food
mm-hmm.
because it's not good for my health. Right? By eating junk food, my health will get it. It's a lifestyle which is correct.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? If you start eating some junk food, your health will get deteriorated.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So people know what is good for health. People know what is good for their job.
Mm-hmm.
People know what is good for their relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Do people know what is good for them in the longer, ultimate sense? What uplifts them, they know.
You mean spiritually?
Mm.
In that sense?
They won't know. That's where the dharma is missing. That part of the dharma is missing.
Uh-huh.
Yes, you said
there is upliftment of thoughts. I mean.
Upliftment and evolution, enlightenment. That is missing.
Yeah. Correct.
Then you said that husband and wife will live in a good life. It is good life.
Mm.
Because they live at a physical level.
Mm.
They live at a psychological level.
Mm.
The spiritual upliftment is
totally missing. Yeah. I see. So then, if one says that, okay, I will get married for the spiritual upliftment, because if the partner is dharmic and follows God and thinks of God, it might actually help me more in turn. Is that possible?
God is a mere concept.
Okay. So then let's say spiritual upliftment of thoughts, right?
The God is a concept. Like this. Most of people, God is a concept.
Okay.
Okay. God as a reality is different from God as a concept.
Agreed. Okay.
The problem with most of the people, we are brought up in a ritualistic environment.
Mm-hmm.
We are not brought up in an environment where spiritual inquiry can happen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, is God a ritual for you or is God a reality for you? There's a gap.
Mm.
Okay.
How do you bridge that gap?
So, that was good.
So,
now, there are a lot of people who are God-fearing.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean by God-fearing?
They do the right things because...
They're afraid of God.
God-fearing person is generally honest. He's afraid of the dharmic consequences.
That is actually coming from a negative understanding of God.
Okay.
Okay. Then there are people who are loving God.
Huh?
Why do they love God?
Maybe they feel blissful within or something, I don't know.
God loving, God fearing, there are two categories.
Okay.
God knowing is different from loving and
okay.
fearing.
Okay. Yeah.
The knowing comes from the right education.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Very point.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Otherwise, God is nothing but a mere concept, glorified concept
mm-hmm.
for most of the people.
Mm-hmm.
No, though it gives joy,
mm-hmm.
no, though it gives happiness, it's a glorified concept.
I'd say that, yeah.
Okay. Sanatana Dharma is not about concepts. Sanatana Dharma is not about rituals. Sanatana Dharma is inquiry into the truth.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's what is required.
But, yeah, that's your point. Yeah, that makes sense. So, there's one more thing in our discussion we didn't speak about.
So, what happens is that ultimately, there will be noise in life when there is a understanding mismatch for the purpose of life.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So, you have seen many of the organizations, right? That's political or any of the organization.
Everywhere.
What happens is that at the grosser level, there's a match. A lot of this thing happens. Then gradually, as you proceed, the organization breaks up because of difference of opinion.
Yeah.
Understand.
Uh-huh.
Understand.
Yeah.
You saw this in the Anna Hazare's movement also.
Yeah.
A lot of the fight was against corruption.
I don't know what happened then.
Then what happened was some people become ambitious. I want to become politician. I want to become... I want to acquire power. So, when people speak of something and coming together, at deeper level, the motivations vary from person to person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay? You understand?
Yeah.
A relationship, an organization can survive when the motivation at the deepest and highest level, they match.
Mm-hmm.
At the surface level matching, somewhere it starts giving friction.
Friction, yeah.
Got it? This applies to marriage, this applies to institution.
No, yeah.
The match has to happen at the deepest and highest level. The match has to happen at this physical, the psychological and spiritual level. It has to.
Okay. No, that is what, right? So my brother and my brother was very much that my parents should find a girl for me. And my friends, they think that they know who the right girl is for me. I have no clue why they think that some particular person is right for me. But I thought that let Amma decide, because then at least I'm not putting in my desire or family desire into it. Because my parents get a girl, so my parents will say, oh, we are getting this girl for you. I said, okay, she's a non-vegetarian,
Kanya varayate rupam mata dhanam. Okay? Bandava sarve bhojanam. So each person looks something in the... The girl sees how rich the boy is. The boy sees how beautiful the girl is.
Okay.
Mother sees, is this boy take care of my girl? All relatives see how good meal I can have and how can I enjoy a party.
Right.
So everybody has their own vision of marriage.
That's what I thought. So I thought that if Amma decides, she as a Mahatma, she can decide who the right person is. Like she asked me what is your nakshatra. I told her what my nakshatra is. She started doing some counts. Okay, nakshatra is Magiram, in Malayalam it is Magiram. Then she stopped at one particular nakshatra. She said, I think the girl should be from this particular nakshatra and that will be the best match for you. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, any astrologer can also do that, but she obviously knows better, I thought, what is right. So she asked me, what do you want? Is it okay? Do you want a Malayali girl, Tamil girl? Amma asked me, I said, whatever Amma wants, I said. But,
so, if you have that faith, then... Don't think anything else.
So that is the uplifting. Okay. So this is earlier days they used to go to a spiritual master
mm-hmm.
for any blessing.
Mm-hmm.
And this you have gone. That's the right thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever Amma says, don't fish it or anything, just take it.
Correct.
Okay. So this is overview of what's happening.
No, because one thing I felt is that, you know, when she asked me about marriage, I told her that I really don't know whether I'll have the Vairagyam in the future. Because now, of course, Amma is there. You know, we go see her, we do our spiritual, or at least try to do our spiritual.
Amma practices. Will be there for millions of years to come.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? If you say Amma as a body,
mm-hmm.
she'll go.
Yeah, right, probably.
Krishna is there for 5,000 years. Krishna
mm-hmm.
will be there another 5 million years.
Mm-hmm.
The Krishna is not a body.
Mm-hmm.
If you're looking at a physical Krishna, Krishna will die.
Mm-hmm.
Krishna has died. But Krishna is not physical. Okay? Krishna is the truth which has told in Bhagavad Gita. Right? Krishna is, okay, so Amma as a physical person will not be the long. But what Amma has established as a teaching, a system, will continue. Okay, that won't lie. So that's why I always again say, an enlightened being has no body. He is no body. But enlightened being has a dharmic body. That dharmic body is the organization they build. Okay, and please understand, the moment you say dharmic, that means there are people who are coming there to learn dharma. So all kinds of people will come.
Correct.
Because realized people don't have to have a body.
Yeah.
Realized people don't have to have organization.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They won't anyway come there. Why they will come?
Mm.
Right?
Dharma, yeah.
All right? Those who want to do something, they will come. So that dharmic body will build. So over a period of time, the dharmic body also becomes polluted. Okay? That's how what happens. Either Krishna's teachings or Buddha's teaching, as the time passes, that body also becomes old. Right? Because people have wrong understanding, that corruption will happen.
Correct.
So then again, that realized being, yada yada hidharmasya glanit bhavati bharata, means you will take another body. People think it's a physical body, it's a dharmic body which will be taken. This is the dharmic body which will be built.
Okay.
Otherwise, physically, you come for 50 years or 60 years and disappear, nothing will happen.
Right.
Okay, people have a wrong understanding of a Jnani.
Yeah.
A Jnani is not physical body. The physical body is taken to build a dharmic body which will last longer.
Okay.
Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhoti bharata. Then dharma becomes, dharma is declines. Means dharmic body declines. Dharmic body which is built at certain point of time start declining. So then you need a new body.
Agreed, yeah.
Okay. So people confuse it as this individual physical body. So whether Amma is there physically or not, her teachings will continue. Okay. The problem what will happen is the people will start interpreting in their own way as the time passes. That realized being means you will take another body. People think it's a physical body, it's a dharmic body which will be taken. This is the dharmic body which will be built.
Okay.
Yeah. Otherwise, physically you come for 50 years or 60 years and disappear, nothing will happen.
Right.
Okay, people have a wrong understanding of a Jnani.
Yeah.
A Jnani is not physical body. The physical body is taken to build a dharmic body which will last longer.
Okay.
Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata. Then dharma becomes, dharma is declines. Means dharmic body declines. Dharmic body which is built at certain point of time start declining. So then you need a new body.
Agreed, yeah.
Okay. So people confuse it as this individual physical body. So whether Amma is there physically or not, her teachings will continue. Okay. The problem what will happen is the people will start interpreting in their own way as the time passes. The corruption happened there.
You're already interpreting.
See, the people who come there, they won't be able to understand. I'll tell you. I mean, where the problem will happen. The problem is, all spiritual teachings are psychological in nature.
Correct. Okay.
People apply it to physical. Okay. So now, there is a teaching. Love thy neighbor. Okay? Right? There's a teaching. So you go and kiss your neighbor. It's physical.
Yeah.
Love is not physical.
Yeah.
Life is a psychological state.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So what happens is the people start understanding and interpreting things at a physical level.
Uh-huh.
Where they are psychological nature.
Uh-huh.
And psychological nature is itself has so much of complexity. Okay? And so much of subtleness.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay? To tell you, this Mahabharata is there to tell you the subtleness of the psychological nature. Mahabharata actually is a classic study of all types of people on the earth. Understand? It is a psychological profiling of all types of people.
Totally agree, yeah.
Okay?
Yeah. I never thought about it, but you're right. Yeah.
It is actually, there is no character in the world who is not reflected in Mahabharata in some way, mm-hmm. and vice versa. Mm-hmm. It's a complete profiling, psychological mm-hmm. profiling. Actually, you know that in America, people do that individual physical profiling, right? Which mm-hmm. carries and all. Mm-hmm. The psychological profiling of human being, what was done was called Mahabharata. Mm-hmm. Right? In Mahabharata, there's a psychological profile. That's called Dharmaraya. Mm-hmm. Who is after Dharma? Okay. Understand? Yeah. Even that guy has question marks. Understand? A person who is really following Dharma, even he starts getting subtle level of doubt at a certain level of evolution. Mm-hmm. Okay, enlightened being doesn't get that. That's different. But a person who is in the path of Dharma will still get
it. Will still get it, yeah.
Okay. That's called Dharma Sankata. Mm.
Okay. Then one thing which I observed was like, so you're saying in a way that the master we know is not the physical body, right? And the
but people need a physical body, okay? People need a physical body.
No, but let's say like now, for example, let's say she's in Europe, mm-hmm. we are here, mm-hmm. right? Now, if I have to pray. I know that the Mahatma is one with God, right? That consciousness is one and the same. So if I am praying to God, if I am praying to the Supreme right now, let's say before I eat my food or whatever actions I do, I am offering to the Supreme. It doesn't matter whether, I mean, she might be physically here or not physically here. It wouldn't technically matter, right?
See, the question is not physical at all. It's not even psychological at all. It's spiritual.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
As spirit, the Chaitanya, everywhere she is there, the presence is everywhere.
So Chaitanya by nature itself is divine. Is consciousness by nature divine? I mean,
no, Chaitanya is only divine.
Okay,
that is the divine.
And now how do you define it then? Is it like all encompassing, present everywhere? Okay,
whatever you call God is actually mm-hmm. Chaitanya.
Okay, okay.
Chaitanyam, Shashwatam, Yoma, Titam, Niranjanam, what they say. The Chaitanya is the consciousness.
Okay.
It is there in you or outside of you.
Okay.
Everywhere, that's called God. Okay. But what happens is that human mind requires a focus.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, mind is so distracted.
Right.
Right. What is everywhere, it becomes difficult to perceive.
Mm-hmm.
So it requires a focus. Then we focus on a personality. The personality is a means, not the end.
Mm-hmm.
Personality is a means to focus.
Yeah, I see your point. I see. Then, one thing is, see, I know one particular person, one girl, she had a boyfriend, okay? And what Amma did was, she literally broke it up. She called this girl and said, I don't want you to be talking with that boy. In fact, I don't want you to get into a relationship with anyone. I want you to focus on me. Literally, imagine a girl in a relationship, she takes out that girl. And I know another person who wanted to be a brahmachari, didn't want to get married. Amma said, nothing doing, you're going to get married. I wanted to get married.
So ultimately, the medicine is based on the disease.
Harish.
Okay.
Okay. The disease of life is called vasana, impressions.
Okay.
What is appropriate for impressions is what has to be done.
Okay.
And that is the difference between a doctor and a quack.
I see.
A doctor will know this is the disease which has to be treated.
Okay. Okay.
A brahmachari, okay, please understand.
Somebody
who is in, wants to take a spiritual life, but his vasana of kama, desire, is not fulfilled.
Mm-hmm.
If he takes a full-time brahmacharya, it becomes a big problem for him and for the society.
I see your point. Yeah.
Okay? The reason is very simple. The desire for sex is a very potent desire.
What about the opposite case?
I'll come to that. Okay? Right? So, okay. Now if you suppress it, it becomes an explosion.
Okay?
So, you need to find a way of expressing it. That's why it is prescribed that you go for marriage.
Okay?
Okay? In the other person's situation, where the desire is there, okay,
but Amma decides it should not
Because that expression itself may lead to more complications for whatever reason.
I see.
Right?
Okay.
Okay. For example, I have a desire to eat food.
Okay.
Okay. So now if I eat food which is grown in a very unhygienic environment, then I may end up in disease.
Mm-hmm.
the desire is legitimate, but the means of fulfillment becomes wrong.
Brahmarpanam Santi Krishna.
And for that disease, it is a proper medicine.
Oh, so they will never prescribe something which they think should not, which is...
Even boyfriend.
Okay? And what Amma did was, she literally broke it up. She called this girl and said, I don't want you to be talking with that boy. In fact, I don't want you to get into a relationship with anyone. I want you to focus on me. Literally. Imagine a girl in a relationship, she takes out that girl. And I know another person who wanted to be a brahmachari, didn't want to get married. Amma said, nothing doing, you're going to get married. I wanted to get married.
So ultimately, the medicine is based on the disease.
Harish.
Okay.
Okay. The disease of life is called vasana, impressions.
Okay.
What is appropriate for impressions is what has to be done.
Okay.
That is the difference between a doctor and a quack.
I see.
A doctor will know this is the disease which has to be treated.
Okay, okay.
A brahmachari, okay, please understand.
Somebody
who is in, wants to take a spiritual life, but his vasana of kama, desire, is not fulfilled.
Mm-hmm.
If he takes a full time brahmacharya, it becomes a big problem for him and for the society.
I see your point. Yeah.
Okay. The reason is very simple. The desire for sex is a very potent desire.
What about the opposite case?
I'll come to that. Okay. Right. So, okay. Now if you suppress it, it becomes an explosion.
Okay.
So, you need to find a way of expressing it. That's why it is prescribed that you go for marriage.
Okay.
Okay. In the other person's situation, where the desire is there, okay.
But Amma decides it should not.
Because that expression itself may lead to more complications for whatever reason.
Oh, I see.
Right?
Okay.
For example, I have a desire to eat food.
Okay.
So now if I eat food which is grown in a very unhygienic environment, then I may end up in disease.
Mm-hmm.
The desire is legitimate,
mm-hmm.
but the means of fulfillment becomes wrong.
I see a point.
Brahmarpanam Santi Krishna.
And for that disease, it is a proper medicine.
Oh, so they will never prescribe something which they think should not, which is...
It is not based on symptom, but it is based on the accurate detection of the problem.
Yeah.
So that is the difference between a good doctor and a bad doctor.
Hmm.
A bad doctor tries to treat the symptom, whereas a good doctor is able to treat the cause.
Finished all your homework?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Because
everyone gets it. A Dhani or Mahatma.
Okay, maybe I'll try it.
A Dhani is called Dhani because he has transcended the mind.
Correct.
Okay?
Okay.
What do you mean by transcending the mind?
Not affected by it.
A transcending the mind means you are not a part of the mind. Okay? Mind is not your subject, mind is your object.
Yeah, correct. Yeah,
okay? Correct. You can be, when you are objective about somebody, there is a clarity. When that person is your relative, then there is a problem.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually a classic example given is Dhritarashtra and his sons. Dhritarashtra was blind to all misdoings of his son. Because there is son. In a metaphoric sense, it is a spiritual blindness.
That is why he is portrayed as blind.
Yeah. I mean, what I'm saying is one is physical story, and metaphorical meaning of that, he is portrayed as a blind person, because when we are blind, okay, we do commit some mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Now this blindness is spiritual blindness. When we are blind to the our mind, we accept whatever mind says as legitimate.
Mm.
Okay. Fine. The real spirituality is the wisdom eye opens when you understand the mind as an object, not as a subject.
Mm. Okay.
And
yeah.
Mind is no longer a subject. Mind is no longer you. Mind is no longer your child.
Mm.
That is called enlightenment. For an enlightened being, the mind becomes an object, not the subject.
Mm.
Now, whose mind becomes object?
Kid in the car.
One who is able to control it.
No control. Control also means a part of that. You drop the mind as the subject.
Mm.
The mind becomes object. Suppose this glass of water is there in front of me as an object, I can see what is there in there.
Mm-hmm.
If this glass of water has gone inside me, I can't see.
Mm-hmm.
What is a part of me, I am blind to that.
Mm.
What is not a part of you, it becomes free.
Mm.
So enlightenment means the mind becomes an object, not the subject.
Mm.
Okay? The mind itself has various layers, so many layers. As you go deeper, the subtle and subtle layers will open up, mind.
Mm.
So even that subtle layer becomes open up for an enlightened being. Now, when that happens to you as a being, okay, then you have understood the mind totality in totality.
Mm-hmm.
When you have understood your mind in totality, you can understand anybody's mind in the world in totality.
Okay.
It is something like this. A car mechanic repairs one car thoroughly. Then bloody any car comes, he can repair.
Mm.
Because if you understand one thing totality, you can understand everything in totality.
Correct. Okay.
That's what happens to enlightened being. They understand the root of their mind in totality.
Mm-hmm.
And once they understand the root of their mind in totality, they can understand the root of mind of anybody in totality.
Mm-hmm.
That's what enlightened being is. So because of that, you understand the mind of the anybody in totality. You understand where the clutch box is problem, where the gearbox is problem. You understand in where the repair has to be done is very clear.
So the Mahatma would never recommend something which is against a person, against a spiritual help for the person.
I would say what is the treatment to be given is given.
Is given, yeah. And they would never give something which is not appropriate.
Yes?
Yeah.
I didn't know you were here. I thought you were in school.
Yeah, I am. I received any